Good afternoon, everybody, respected dignitaries online. Today we have the first day of our refresher course, and we are in the post-lunch session of the refresher course. Eminent speaker. I'm joined. हाँ चालू हो गई आप join हो जाना join हो जाओ आप आपके जिन सर कर रहे हैं I now welcome our head department, Professor P. Vidyavardhini, madam. Madam, kindly introduce our speaker, Professor K. N. Ganesha, sir. Over to Vidya, madam.
Thank you, Halim Khan. Good afternoon, sir, Professor C. Ganesha, sir. And
good afternoon, madam.
It gives me immense pleasure to introduce Professor K.N. Ganeshaya. He is a retired Dean, Postgraduate Studies and Professor and Head Department of Forestry and Environmental Sciences and School of Ecology and Conservation, University of Agricultural Sciences, GKVK, Bangalore. Sir has completed his PhD in Agricultural Sciences in Bangalore in the year 1983. His MSc in UAS Bangalore in 1979 and BSc also in UAS Bangalore in 1976. He held various positions like Dean Postgraduate Studies and Head of the Department of Forestry and Environmental Sciences, University of Agricultural Sciences, Bangalore, India. He received different honors like Fulbright Fellow USA in the year 1991, Parisara Prashasti Karnataka State Environment Award from the Department of Ecology and Environment, Government of Karnataka in the year 1997. Vocational Excellence Award by Rotary Club of Bangalore, Yala Hankar in the year 2008. Karnataka Sahitya Academy Dakti Award 2008 for the Kannada novel, Kanaka Musuku in the year 2009. British Petroleum Award for Resource Substitution, the Ryotaro Hashinamoto APFED Award, Gold Prize for Promoting Indigenous Use of Plant Invasive Lantana Camera by Asia Pacific Forum for Environment and Development, Japan in the year 2009. Radio Hope and Awareness Media Award for the International Radio Forum in the year 2010. he has got recognitions from different scientific bodies. He is a fellow of Indian Academy of Sciences, Bangalore, since 1991. Fellow of Indian National Science Academy, New Delhi, since 1997. Fellow National Academy of Agricultural Sciences, New Delhi, since 2004. Fellow Current Science Association, Bangalore. Honorary Senior Fellow, Jawaharlal Nehru Center for Advanced Scientific Research, Bangalore. Senior Fellow, Ashoka Trust for Research in Ecology and Environment, Bangalore, India. He's an editor. Is a member of the editorial board and has done rendered other services related to publications like in Current Science in 1991, My Forest in 1991, International Journal of Farmer Phytomorphology, Proceedings of Indian National Science Academy in
2000.
Of Sciences series, Biodiversity of India. He is a member of various government related committees, national task forces, selection committees, and to name a few, international working group, Fellow Caucus Pondicherry. He's the Research Council for Department of Forest. Expert panel for Rubber Research Institute. He's a member for Ashoka Trust for Research Institute of India, member executive board for it, and he's an expert committee. Central Silk Board, Bangalore. He's a research advisory council for member in Salim Ali Center for Ornithology and Natural History, Coimbatore. Member for Oxfam Advisory Committee, Animal Behavior and Ecology. He is an executive committee in Eastern and Western Ghats, Ministry of Environment and Forest, life member, International Union for Study of Social Insects. Is a founder member of Ecology and Natural Resource Unit, UAS, Bangalore, life member, Ethological Society of India, founder, trustee, Ashoka Trust, member, Marine Coastal Ecology, associate member, National Institute of Advanced Studies, IISc, Bangalore, Research Advisory Council member, Seri Biotech, Bangalore, member expert group of an application of biotechnology for biodiversity conservation, NBDB, DBT, New Delhi. He's a member task force of rejuvenating BSI and ZSI constituted by the Ministry of Environment from the year 2009 to 2010. He's a chairman for establishing a web portal for Karnataka Bioresources by KSCGST. Just a few things are over. And he has got many publications. He has got 163 research articles, 11 books, 37 papers in books, 14 proceedings, 15 popular articles, and he has written many books in Kannada as well as in English, and he has guided around 15 PhD scholars, delivered around 150 talks, and he's authored so many books, and he has so many important books like Bheemanna Bheema, which is an essay collection, Kala Garba, which is a 25 episode, which is
series.
And to name a few, sir, Ganeshaya, sir, it's so immense to be with you once again, sir. You were from the beginning in our lecture talk, sir. And I welcome you, sir, for this program, and all over to you, sir. Thank God bless you, sir.
Thank you, madam. Thank you very much for this long introduction. That was wonderful to hear. Though it may not be very useful to the listeners. Thank you very much. Dr. Khan.
You can see, sir.
Okay. Well, let me also welcome all the participants of this workshop to this talk. What I'll be doing in the next 45 minutes to 1 hour is speak to you on how biodiversity and the species interactions or interactions among the components of biodiversity would lead to a lot of ecosystem services, and how these ecosystem services are useful for our own survival and almost every day's life that we lead. I am from the University of Agricultural Sciences. Now let me start with a coffee cup that you all will be drinking almost every day. If you ask the question, how much of biodiversity is there in every coffee cup that you drink? Probably we think that there is very limited. What is there in a coffee cup? In a coffee cup, there is, of course, the coffee powder, sugar, and the milk. But is this all that we have got in our coffee cup? Or if you want to now drink a cup of coffee, is that all that goes into that? You will see that, of course, in addition to coffee powder, we also add chicory, we also add sugar, and of course the milk. And each of them actually comes from several interactions among the species. What I will do today is just take one among them, that is the coffee powder, the major ingredient of our coffee cup. If you now just take the coffee powder, how much of biodiversity, how much of web of life, how much of species interactions, and what kind of complex interactions that get into prepare that one spoon of coffee powder that you use in your coffee cup. Of course, we know coffee seeds come from the coffee plants. And if you ask the question, is the coffee powder that we get from the coffee seeds, is the coffee plant the only source from where we get this coffee powder, or is it the only contributor to our coffee powder? In other words, is coffee plant the only biological resource contributing to our coffee powder that we drink every day? If we ask this question, you'll be surprised to see that no, answer is just not the coffee powder or the coffee plant. There are hundreds of species. In fact, I can actually quote on a less conservative way, several thousands of species interact to bring that one spoon of coffee powder into your cup. I may not be able to give you all these interactions. In fact, there is such a complex level of interactions that go into the production of coffee powder that I will not be able to give in this 1 hour all of that. Nevertheless, I'll try to give a small sample of what all species, how many diverse kinds of species, and what kind of complex interactions are there that would eventually lead us to drink this cup of coffee. If you now take a coffee plant, for instance, we know that this coffee plant requires several microorganisms for its growth. The phosphorus solubilizing microorganisms, though coffee may not directly fix nitrogen with the rhizobia like organisms, there are a number of nitrogen fixing organisms in the soil which fix the nitrogen, and the plant derives them from that. The VM mycorrhiza species that give so many nutrients from the soil to the plant. Tens of endophytic fungi and bacteria that live inside the plant tissue. I'm sure Dr. Khan would arrange some talk where endophytic fungi and bacteria also will be exposed to you in due course of this course. In addition to that, the pathogens and their parasitic microorganisms that attack the coffee or that are controlling the parasites, both in the soil, on the leaf, and on the flowers, on the plants. Of course, in addition to that, the pollinators. So any number of such organisms are involved. In addition to that, we also know that the coffee we get is also a consequence of the interaction of the plant with the herbivores that attack the plant also. The herbivores could be caterpillars or bugs or beetles or any such insect, even for that matter, other higher organisms also. Let me now start with this herbivore as the focal point to now put across by my point that the coffee we get out of coffee plant is actually a consequence of very, very complex interactions. But let us concentrate on these herbivores. Herbivores that actually eat the plant or eat the leaves or eat the flowers or even the coffee powder. There are coffee stem borers, coffee pod borer, etc. So let us take all herbivores together as one community. Now these herbivores are known to be eaten by the spiders that live again in the coffee ecosystem. And they are also known to be eaten by the vertebrates such as birds and some squirrels or even large vertebrates when they visit the plantation. But let's not go into all those complications. Only take this triangle between the coffee herbivore community, the spiders and the birds. Now, there have been a number of studies on understanding how these interactions are actually taking place. Just to give a small example, let us say we remove this vertebrate from the entire coffee ecosystem. We somehow put a net on the coffee plantation, make sure that the birds don't enter at all, and then we'll see what happens. But before that, let me also tell you that the arrow marks here that I am showing also indicate the extent of interactions. What do I mean by that? If you now look at the arrow between the bird and the spider, it is rather thick, showing that bird eats on spiders much more than the bird eating on the community of the insects, or the herbivores that attack the plant. So when we now remove the bird, what happens is the spider community is now increased its population because bird is not there anymore. So spider's community size. Hello?
Excuse me. Sir, your slides are not moving.
Are not moving?
Slides are not moving, yes.
No. Is it moving now?
No.
Not now?
Yeah.
They're moving, right?
You again stop sharing and you start again sharing, sir.
Oh. Screen sharing has stopped as a shared window is closed. Oh my God. I see. How about now?
Yeah, it is coming now.
Yeah. It's fine now?
Yeah, it is fine.
Okay. Yeah, sorry about that. So if you now look at the community of herbivores and the interactions of these herbivores with the bird and the spider, what you see is that there is a thick line between spider and the bird, which suggests that bird eats more on spider than on the herbivores. And also note that spider in turn eats on the herbivores. So what happens if I now remove the bird? Let us say we put a net on the entire coffee ecosystem and we remove the bird. When we remove the bird, because the bird is eating more on spiders than on the herbivores, we expect that the number of spiders or the community of spiders would increase in the coffee ecosystem. So the expectation is that there will be an increase in the spider population when we remove the vertebrate bird. But what actually happened was indeed the same. Indeed, the spider population increased. However, we also know that as the spider population increases, we expect that the herbivore population also should decrease because spider eats on the herbivores. As the spider population increases, because there are more spiders to eat on the herbivore population should go down. There should be a decrease in the pest level on the coffee plantation. So you remove the bird population from the ecosystem, the spider population should increase, and that increase in spider population should now eat on the herbivores. So herbivore level should come down, which means the damage to the coffee should increase. But actually what happened was the reverse. In fact, when they removed the vertebrate population from the ecosystem, there was an increase in the herbivore population. There was no decrease. Now, this obviously surprised the scientists, and when they carefully examined, they found that there is a parasitoid that actually attacks the herbivores. And this parasitoid actually is eaten by the spider. So when we remove the bird, when the spider population increases, the increased spider population removes the parasitoid. So when the parasitoid is removed, parasitoid attacking the herbivores goes down. The parasitization of the herbivores goes down, and when they are free from the parasitization of the from the parasitoid, their population increases, their growth increases, and so there is gradually an increase in the herbivore population. In other words, the point I am trying to make here is that the interactions are not linear, in the sense they are not as simple as they are visible to our eye. There are unseen interactions that now get into this whole complex web of life that would now need to be understood by a biologist before we execute any regulatory mechanism to increase our production. Now, here is the ecosystem service. Ecosystem service are operating in different levels. The vertebrate bird eats on the spider eats on the parasitoid eats on the herbivores. So there is a complex relation here. So in other words, removal of vertebrates increases the herbivore populations. As a result, the spider, which is a carnivore, population increased. That in turn ate or, you know, affected the parasite population. And after 6 months, parasitoids on the herbivores reduced. And as a result, the herbivore population increased. So thus you see that the cup of coffee that we drink is a result of the fact that the coffee is protected from its herbivores by the birds, by the spiders, and by the parasites. So the biodiversity of this ecosystem of the coffee ecosystem is in fact contributing to our coffee drinking or our coffee yield. When we walk into a coffee ecosystem, we may see hundreds of insects, hundreds of flies, hundreds of spiders, hundreds of vertebrates. We do not realize the contribution of all of them to our coffee. But through this kind of experiments, people have shown that there are unseen, invisible, ununderstandable, complex relations among the biodiversity elements or the species that eventually result in the production of the coffee. As a matter of fact, these interactions are responsible for the establishment and collapse of the coffee cultivation all over the world. In fact, there is a rust species called Himalaya vastatrix, which affects the coffee plant on the leaves. As you can see on the left-hand side bottom, the rust affects the leaves. And this has led to abandonment of the coffee estates all over the world in different periods of time. I have given these time periods on the right-hand side. In 1945 in Asia, in 1867 in Sri Lanka, 1888 in Malaysia and those countries, in 1979 to 81 in Mexico and Central America, and in Madagascar in 1904. So coffee plantations were abandoned because of the detrimental or devastating effect of this rust on coffee. And why did this happen? I'll come to that. Though the entire world was affected by this coffee rust in Sri Lanka, Sumatra, and Java, there was one exception where this was not happening. Incidentally, the rust, as I told, is affected by microorganism or Himalaya vastatrix, and this affects both Coffea arabica and Coffea canophora or robusta coffee, which are the two most important commercial coffee species. There are, of course, 25 other coffee species, and as of now, there are no alternate hosts that have been identified or yet been found on this. So as I told, the rust devastated the coffee worldwide, and the main cause in all these places was found to be this organism, but with one exception. What is that? While the entire world suffered from this rust, in Latin America, this rust was not found to be a very serious problem. Now, why is that? Why is that in Latin America, this rust could not actually cause the same devastating effect on coffee cultivation as it happened elsewhere in the world? The reason turned out to be one simple change in the cultivation practice. Now, Latin America continued to now maintain high level of biodiversity on its farms or its coffee plantations, as you can see on the left-hand side. Diversity of trees were grown, and thick trees were still being grown as a shade trees of coffee plantation. And the coffee plantation was grown under the canopy, thick canopy of the trees. Whereas in Sri Lanka, India, Java, Sumatra, and all those places, because they wanted to have intensive coffee cultivation, they reduced the density of the trees. And because they reduced the density of the trees in these areas, such as Java, Sumatra, Sri Lanka, and India, and those places, rust devastated the entire crop. Whereas when they maintain the tree population and the tree diversity very densely in the coffee plantation, as it happened in Latin America, coffee cultivation was not devastated by the rust. Now, what is this link between tree cultivation and rust impact on the coffee? Now, this is where the most interesting relation comes about. And to understand this, we have to go through a complex, web of life that relates the cultivation of trees as shade trees to the coffee and the rust that affects the coffee plant. Let me now start telling the details of these complex interactions. In other words, what we are trying to understand here is that how is that trees are contributing the most important ecosystem service to control the coffee rust. Presence of trees somehow now reduces the impact of coffee rust. How is that? Now, coffee leaves, of course, are infested by the coffee rust, as I've been telling. And this rust is incidentally hyper-parasitized by another fungus called Lecanus ileum lecani, which is also called as the white hollow fungus. So there is rust on that plant leaf, and that rust is now hyperparasitized by another white fungus. How is that white fungus? This is the white fungus. As you can see, white fungus grows on the rust and controls the rust. So as long as this white fungus grows, the impact of the rust will be less on the plant. So let us now construct what we know so far. The different levels of trophic level get constructed in the slide after slide, as you can see. So there is coffee rust on the coffee leaves, and this rust is affected by or is parasitized by another fungus called white hollow fungus. Incidentally, this white hollow fungus not only affects the rust, but it also grows on the coffee scale in Coccus viridis. It also grows on the back of the body of the scale insect. How is that? These are the scale insects on the coffee plant, and these are all its larvae. And on this scale insects, that white hollow fungus grows. You can see here, the center of each of this white patch here in this scale, sorry, in this slide, is a scale insect, and around that, there is this white fungus. In other words, white fungus population increases as the scale insect increases on the coffee plantation. Remember, our task is to now find the relation between trees and the rust. We still have not come to the trees. I'll come to the trees a little later. What we have understood so far is that there is rust on the coffee leaves, and that rust is affected by the white fungus, and the white fungus also grows on the scale insect that affects the coffee plants. So reconstruct the whole story. There are coffee leaves on which coffee rust occurs, on which the white hollow fungus parasitizes, and this white fungus also grows on the coffee scale insect. Now, this fungus, of course, attacks the green coffee scale insect called Coccus viridis. But there is also a mutualism that exists between this scale insect and the ants called Aztec ants. This Aztec ant is also called as Azteca, some species. Now, these two are mutually living together. As and when ants are there on the coffee plant, they help the scale insect to be moved from one place where the food is over to another place, because scale insects cannot move on their own. They are stuck to one place. Ants carry them and leave it to another place. And thus, the population of the scale insect increases as the ant population increases. Now, what do ants get out of this? Ants get nectar from the scale insect, which they now drink from the back of the scale insect. So ants increase the infected scales, and hence the, now as the scale insect increases, the white fungus again population grows on that, and so the population of the white fungus increases, and as the white fungus increases, as I already told, the rust level decreases. So as you can see, the mutualism between the ant and the scale insect is now increasing the white fungus, because more the ants, more the scale insects, more the scale insects, more the surface area for the white fungus to grow. And as the white fungus grows, the rust gets reduced. So reconstruct the diagram again. There are coffee leaves. I'll be repeating this kind of diagram again and again so that we don't lose track of the continuous web of life. There are coffee leaves on which coffee rust occurs, on which hollow fungus grows. And this hollow fungus also grows on the scale insects, and the scale insects are attended by the ants, and there is mutualism between scale insects and ants. Now, these ants nest in the shade trees available on the top of the coffee plantation. Ants cannot nest in the coffee plants because they require thick canopy, vast canopy, and they also require thick leaves and broad leaves. They twine between the leaves and they make their nest. And so more the shaded trees, more the ants, more the ants, more the coffee scale insect, more the coffee scale insect, more will be the population of white hollow fungus, and more the white hollow fungus, more will be the, I mean, less will be the coffee rust, and so coffee rust will be controlled. In other words, wherever you have thick density and diversity of the coffee shade trees, as it was being cultivated in the Latin America, there will be more ants which in series of these interactions controls or reduces the rust. Thus, growing the shade trees was actually costing to the growth of the rust on the leaves, liberating the coffee cultivation from the impact or devastating impact of the rust. And thus in Latin America, coffee cultivation was not affected because of the cultural practice that they follow. In other words, shaded trees protect the leaves, and thus there is an ecosystem service of the shade trees on the coffee cultivation. More you cultivate the shade trees, more healthy is the plant, more will be the productivity. And that is the reason why in Latin America, the rust could not devastate the entire set of coffee cultivation. Whereas in Java and Sumatra, where trees were not there, ants were not there, the scale insects could not multiply, and so the white fungus could not multiply, and hence rust increased in its population, and so coffee cultivation was devastated. So one conclusion I would like to draw before we go ahead is that if we have more trees in a coffee ecosystem, there will be less coffee rust, but more coffee for the drinkers. But this does not stop here. The interactions that I've been talking about, the number of species that contribute to our coffee powder or every spoon of coffee powder, extends beyond this level. Let me now give you from this focal point of scale insects. We now understand the role of scale insects in the control of the coffee rust. Now, these scale insects, incidentally, are predated or eaten by a beetle called coccinellate beetle or Azia verbigera. Do not bother about the species name. It's beaten by a coccinellate beetle. And so you will automatically guess that if there are more coccinellate beetles, there will be less of the scale insect. And when there is less of scale insect, there is less of the white fungus and there will be more of rust. Incidentally, Aztec ants that help the scale insect to spread also attack the adult beetles and protect the scale insects by patrolling in the entire area. They move around on the coffee plant, they attack the adult coccinellate beetles and thus reduce the population of the coccinellate beetles, promoting the health, growth of the scale insects. So you will see that the mutualism between ants and the scale insects is just not direct in terms of transportation and they getting the nectar. There is also an indirect link through the coccinellate beetles. Coccinellate beetles are controlled by the Aztec ants. Now, here are some shots or photographs or slides of how ants attack the coccinellate beetle. This is the coccinellate beetle. And as you can see here on the left-hand side, so diagram C, ants are actually literally, physically, violently attacking the coccinellate beetle. Now on the right-hand side, what you see is the larvae of the coccinellate beetles. Now they have a covering around them, and that covering, as you can see here by the ants, is eaten away by the ants. Now what you can see here on the top slide, that is slide number B, is that the larva of the coccinellate beetle is actually eating the scale insect. And here, ant is eating on the cover of the larva, and that way it is removing the protective cover. That way the survival ability of the larva also goes down. You can see that there are a number of different kinds of behavioral interactions that come into play here. So let us reconstruct what we so far studied. There is scale insect, which is attacked by the coccinellate beetle. Coccinellate beetle is attacked by the ant, and ant in turn does help the scale insect. Now, there is a problem. What is the problem? These coccinellate beetles have to lay their eggs under the scale insect, body of the scale insect. Why? Because their eggs will be otherwise eaten by the ants. And so they have to lay their eggs under the scale insect. But why do they? How do they do that? Whenever they go to the scale insect, of course, the ants will come and attack them. So the gravid beetles of the coccinellate beetle, that is the female gravid females, they lay their eggs underneath the scale insect where ants cannot move. Otherwise, ants could remove their eggs. So how do the castanet beetles do that? There's a very interesting story again here. Now, there is a parasitic fly called Pseudoxanthion, belonging to the family Phoridae, which actually attacks the Aztec ants. They attack Aztec ants, and ants can actually sense the arrival of this parasitic fly. Whenever they, and how do they attack? They actually drop the eggs on the ants, and when these ants go back to the nest, those eggs grow on the larva of the ants, and so ant population will be now affected by this parasitic fly, parasitic and the ants. And so whenever the ants sense the arrival of this parasitic fly, they run away from the site, they go and hide in their nest, or they become very static. As if, you know, we say to the kid's statue, and the kid stands in this original position, wherever the, whatever the position he is in, like that, the presence of the parasitic fly puts a kind of behavioral change in the ants, where they suddenly became a statue-like and immobile, like that. Now, as long as the fly is there moving around to lay eggs, the reason why ants go to the statue-like status is that flies cannot lay eggs on the static ants. They only can locate the ants when they are mobile. If they are static, the vision of the fly is unfortunately so bad that they can't identify the ants. Only when they are moving, they can move, fly along with their movement and drop the eggs on them. So when the ant becomes static, parasitic fly cannot locate it. Now, when the ant is static, these coccinellid beetle females, they immediately move beneath the scale insect and they lay their eggs under the body of the scale insect. But how do they guess? How do they get the clue that I can go and actually lay eggs now? It so happens that ant, when it becomes the statue-like, the moment any ant sights a parasitic fly, it staples its mobility, becomes static. At that moment, any ant that locates the parasitic fly and goes into the statue mode releases a pheromone so that it alerts all other ants to become static so that they are not parasitized by this parasitic fly. So all ants become statue-like. Now, when this ant sends out that pheromone, that pheromone is sensed by the coccinellid beetle female, and female now gets the clue that ants are going to be static now, and suddenly moves towards the scale insects and lay their eggs under the scale insects. What is surprising is that this pheromone is sensed only by the females and not by the males. To that extent, this perception of the behavior, or perceptive behavior, has been evolved. So the female beetles and not the males are attracted to scale insects only when the ants are under attack by the phorid flies, and the attraction to ant pheromone is manifested only in the females that are gravid. And pheromones of ants thus alert their colleagues, and because of which the beetle females also get alerted and they go and lay their eggs. This is the statue-like photo of the ant. And you might be actually seeing this kind of behavior among the ants now and then, you know, all of a sudden they become static. We may be wondering why they are becoming static, but you would see that many of these behaviors are actually linked to their own survival strategy. Survival strategy that they cannot, they adapt to increase their survival. So Azteca instabilis, the keystones, in other words, in the whole of this system here, you will see that Aztec ants actually are the keystone species of the entire network. They promote the growth of the scale insect. They help the movement of the scale insect. They also now control the infestation of the scale insect or attack on the scale insect by the coccinellid beetles. Thus, the entire ecosystem's balance is actually maintained by these ants. So the white fungus disease caused by the organism Lecanium lecani attacking the green coffee scale insects is controlled by the ants, and thus ants become the keystone species. Now this diagram shows, in some sense, all possible interactions. I do not want to go into these complexities, but just remind you back that ants are attacked by the four-eared flies. And when the ant is going to be attacked by the four-eared flies, ant enters into a static state, which alerts the females of the coccinellate beetles by the pheromone that ant emits. And they go and lay eggs under the scale insect. And this scale insect is eaten by the coccinellate larvae. And the entire ecosystem is controlled by these complex interactions. So to come back to the point, we have found that the coffee that we drink every day, or the cup of coffee we hold in our hand every day, is a result of several hundred subspecies. Note that just the coffee itself comes from all these interactions among several species. How about chicory? Chicory also will have similar interactions among several tens and hundreds of subspecies interacting among themselves. The sugar coming from sugarcane also is a consequence of several such hundreds of species. And of course, the milk that we get is from the cow, which eats on the fodder, and that fodder will have again hundreds of such interactions. And we don't know how many different organisms are there in the cow's stomach, cow's body, cow's survival lifespan, where several hundreds and thousands of species could be now interacting with the... Hello? 1 minute, please, Amelie. So as you can see, that the coffee production is a result of these hundreds of species of coffee, chicory, sugar, milk, and the microorganisms and the parasites, predators growing on all of them. Thus, your coffee cup is a result of several hundreds of species and their interactions that are generally not appreciated by us when we now drink a cup of coffee. So coffee is an excellent system, and it's an excellent end product of ecosystem interactions. Several hundreds of species actually are contributing to its production. All interactions, all kinds of interactions happen among them. And when you take a sip of coffee, you are stomaching all these interactions. In addition to that, your coffee kick is a result of all this and plus a vast biological diversity and ecological interactions that we face. We do not generally see in the ecosystems. Now, ecosystem services actually do not contribute to food or coffee or this kind of end product to us. They also now contribute to the stability of the entire ecosystem. And perhaps I will try to now take up this topic in another session sometime tomorrow, where how tiny pollinators and their association with the keeps the entire ecosystem in balance, and the entire ecological balance of the ecosystem, and hence our survival and the survival of several thousands of organisms depends on a small tiny pollinator. I will perhaps be now explaining that in another session that I'll be taking up in the next class. Dr. Khan?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I would like to stop here because I don't want to burden the participants with too much of material. I'll come on to the second topic later. I have this topic here, but I'll take it up in the next class. Let us see if there are any questions that we would like to now get from the students. Participants.
At this moment, there are no questions, sir. It is very interesting, sir. I was mesmerized again. What way you want to say... you brief the things, though. Really, nature is such a great creation, really. It's a... really, we can't even guess how God has created this nature, really. Very interesting. Sir, you continue, sir.
Okay.
See, any chat is already...
No, frankly, I am also tired. See, I have listed that material here, I have, but I feel I now will start going fast if I now start this second element. I'll perhaps take it up in the next session. kindly let us stop now. You know, my fatigue level also will reach. Let us see if the people have any questions. Maybe we'll try to interact with them and then see if there are any questions. And if they want anything else, I can now also speak up. Yeah. I will come on to a video.
Sure, sir.
Yeah. Yes. This is to all the participants. If any of you have any questions, let us now interact on that. If any doubts.
One second. One participant is raising the hand.
Okay. Yeah. Let him ask the question. We will interact because, you know, there may be some doubts about the whole process of this. Yeah.
Good afternoon, yeah, sir. I am Prasanna from the Department of Banking. Yes, sir. Sir, you were saying regarding hormones released by ant, sir.
Yeah.
So you were saying that when the ants become statue, they release some pheromones, na, sir.
Yes.
So whenever the ant becomes statue, for every it releases the pheromones, sir, or yes, only during that.
Yeah. You see, the ant becomes a statue only when it sights the parasite.
Okay.
And when it sights the parasite, it wants to alert its friends. Look here, there is parasite coming. You also go to statue. Otherwise, you will lay the eggs. So that's why it emits the pheromone. That pheromone alerts all the ants. They all become static immediately. Am I clear? Hello. Yeah, Dr. Khan, who is that who was asking the question? Just check if she got the answer correctly.
Yes, sir. I got the answer correctly, sir.
Okay, great.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Any others who want to ask any questions? Okay. Yeah, Dr. Khan.
Sir.
Yeah, I am through with the talk now. If there are no questions.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Shall I go out then?
Sir, your video you were told, no? You have showing some video.
No. I'm not going to show any video now.
Speaker, we have not informed our next speaker. He is joining at 2:30 or 2:45, it says.
Okay. So we still have about 15 minutes.
Yeah.
Okay. Then let me now do this. Maybe I will get back to this talk and start my next talk little so that I will leave it later. Okay. Let me come here. Is my screen visible? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Screen sharing has stopped. Let me come to this. Okay. Share. Fine. This I will go out. Wait. I have to use it to these new systems. Okay, that is minimized. And I want to now go to PowerPoint. Yeah, I will occupy another 15 minutes. I will perhaps start the next talk that I wanted to and continue in the next space interactions. Yes. Yeah. Yeah, is my screen visible?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So I was now trying to indicate that interactions among the species also leads to the ecosystem stability. And there are a number of such examples where keystone species maintain the stability of the ecosystem. I will now try to present one case. And before I go to present that one case, let me also now tell you the conceptual basis of species interactions. So far, we now studied how there are parasites, predators, mutualism, etc. Now, all of them can be brought into one framework. I will now perhaps present that framework so that all that we discussed so far falls into a conceptual structure of these species interactions. Let us say there are two partners in any interactions, partner A and partner B. Now, in this case, I have taken a plant and I have taken an insect. Plant is pollinated by the insect, or insect pollinates the plant, and this kind of interaction, in this kind of interaction, there is benefit to both plant and to the insect. There is also cost to both plant and to the insect. For example, what is the benefit to the plant? Plant gets pollinated. If it doesn't get pollinated, the seeds are not set. And so there is a benefit to the plant. But what is the cost to the plant of this pollination? Well, there is a cost to the plant. Plant, if at all it has to attract the insect, insect will not easily come. It has to now provide some, let us say, reward to the insect. And what kind of reward it can offer? Reward that the insect will be now attracted by, for instance, the nectar and the pollen. The insects are known to now visit the plants to drink the nectar and eat the pollen. And so plant has to produce so much amount of nectar that it attracts the insect, and also so much amount of pollen that in addition to sending the pollen grains for pollination, the pollen grains that are eaten by the insects also are to be now produced by the plant. So there is a cost to the plant. At the same time, if this benefit to cost ratio to the plant is more than one, what does that mean? That means there is more benefit to the plant than what it is investing. The investment is nectar and pollen. The benefit is the pollination. If the pollination benefit to the plant is more than the investment it is putting into in terms of cost, that is nectar and pollen, then the plant is gaining. We say plant is gaining in terms of its interaction with the insect. Similarly, there is a benefit and cost to the insect also. What is the benefit? By visiting the plant, the insect is getting the pollen and the nectar, which actually feeds or provides nutrients to the insect. But at the same time, that insect has to carry the pollen grains from one plant to the other, and that transportation is an additional cost that the insect has to bear. So there is a cost of transportation that it has to invest. And if the benefit it is getting is more than the cost, if B by C is more, then insect is also gaining. In this situation, where both the plant and insect are gaining, despite the fact that both of them are investing and both of them are getting some benefit, if the B by C is greater than one for both of them, we call such an interaction as mutualism. We saw in the presentation that I just presented, there is a mutualism between Aztec ant and the scale insects. But in the same scenario, we also found a different kind of interaction. What is that? Let us say the insect affects the plant. For instance, by herbivores who are eating on coffee plant. And that kind of situation is entirely different from mutualism, because in this, the plant is loser. The plant is being eaten by the insect, and insect is a gainer. Insect is now getting nutrients from the plant, but in turn is not giving anything to the plant. That kind of interactions are called antagonistic interactions, in which case one among the partners loses or both may lose. We'll also provide some examples where both may lose a little later. So these kind of interactions are called antagonistic interactions. So the interspecific interactions, as you can see, can be now represented on two dimensions. The dimensions are the two partners, of course, and each of them has its own benefit and the costs. And if the benefit to, the benefit to cost ratio incidentally can vary from zero to more than one. How more zero to more than one? Let us say in this case, in the previous example where plant is losing, the benefit is zero, but there is a cost. What is the cost? It is losing its leaves, losing its fruits, losing its seeds, losing its flowers if the insect eats away all of them. So there is a cost. So benefit is zero, but cost is high. And so B by C is zero by something. Whereas the parasite that is eating on the herbivore that is eating on the plant gets lots of benefits. It has no investment at all, but it gets lots of benefits. So benefit could be even more than one. It can even go up to infinity. So this B by C are evolutionary benefits and costs are actually defining what is the kind of linkage or relation between the two. Now, when we say evolutionary benefit and evolutionary costs, we cannot simply measure this in terms of the weight of the nectar or the weight of the pollen or the weight of the pollen grains that are carried away or the energy that the insect is now losing in transportation or the amount of biomass that the insect is in. No, we can't carry, we equate them only in that. We have to convert all of them into the reproductive success that each of these partner is gaining or losing because of those benefits and costs. So it is a reproductive gain or reproductive loss due to the act that they're indulging in. Now, all this can be represented as a space of benefit to cost between the two partners. Let us say the x-axis is the B by C of the benefit to cost ratio to the plants and y-axis is B by C or benefit to cost ratio to the insects. Is a slide visible? Hello?
Yes, sir. Yes, it is visible, sir. Visible, sir.
Okay, okay. Thank you. So you will see here that I have divided the whole of this space. I told you that the benefit to cost ratio to the plants ranges from zero to more than one or even up to infinity. So also for the insect on the y-axis, the benefit to cost ratio from vary from zero to more than one or even infinity. Now draw a line which exactly corresponds to B by C is equal to one. What is the meaning of that? Benefit is equal to cost, which means the partner is getting only as much as is investing. Or B is equal to C, or benefit is equal to cost, or B by C is equal to 1. This could happen both for the plants and also for the insects. Now draw those lines and divide the whole of the space, and you will see that there are four quadrants. Quadrant number 1, where benefit to cost ratio to both the partners is less than 1. Quadrant number 2, where B by C is more than 1 to 1 and less than 1 to another. Or another antagonistic interaction where B by C is more than 1 to plants and less for the insects. Or there is a fourth quadrant on the top right, big quadrant, where B by C to both the plants and the insects is where is more than 1. Now let us define these quadrants now. How do we define these quadrants? Let us take the first quadrant, where benefit to cost ratio to both the insect and the plant is less than 1, which means both of them are losing. A situation, an interaction, or the interspecific interaction where both the species lose is actually competition. There is no way where competition can result in positive gains to both of them, or even to one among them. Whenever there is a competition, both of them compete, either one among them wins, or till one among them wins, both will be now losing because they'll be fighting, struggling with each other. Now, the other quadrant is the one where benefit to cost ratio is more than one for the plant and less than one for the insect. Meaning what? In this quadrant, plant has more benefit than the cost. Plant is gaining, but insect is having benefit to cost ratio less than one. That means insect is losing. Now, what are the situations where insect loses and the plant gains? These are the insectivorous plants, such as Nepenthes or Drosera, where the insect that comes and sits on the plant is eaten away by the plant. So the plant gains and insect loses. This is a perfect antagonistic relation. There is another antagonistic relation, quadrant number 3, where the herbivore or the plant, insect gains, but the plant loses. What are the situations? When the plant losing is a situation where insect eats on the plant, that is the herbivore situation. In the example of the coffee plantations, coffee interactions, that is a focal point I took of the herbivores on the coffee plant. So as you will see that there is an antagonistic interaction where the plant is losing, but insect is gaining. And there is this fourth quadrant, very peculiar quadrant. This peculiar quadrant is actually very interesting quadrant because in this, both the plant and the insects are gaining. The benefit to cost ratio to both the plant and the insect is more than one. As I told in the very first slide, when both the partners are gaining by the investment they are doing and the benefits they are getting, if the BYC is more than one, that area is called as mutualism. But let me also now put here, what does these lines that we drew at exactly BYC is equal to one represent? They represent what is called commensalism, where one among the partners does not gain anything at all, but the other will either be gaining. For instance, if you now take this commensalism along the plants, then BYC to one among the partners is one. There is no gain at all for that, whereas the plant is gaining, commensalism. Now, commensalism, for the best example for this is, let us say, the hermit crabs. Hermit crabs are those where a crab goes and occupies the covering of a dead shell in the oceans. The owner of the shell is dead. Because the owner of the shell is dead, it is neither gaining nor losing. So B by C for that is one, because there is no benefit, no cost, and so there is no gain or no loss. So B by C is one. Whereas the crab that goes and occupies the shell will get lot of protection from the shell, and so it is gaining. B by C is more. It is not having any cost at all. Oh, anything is only benefit for it. And so that is commensalism. So you see that this space of B by C between the two partners, be it insects and plants or whatever it is, any two partners, if you now map this space on the B by C between the two partners, all the interactions that we can see in the world, all the interactions that we can see in the web of life can be captured. There is competition, there is antagonism, there is herbivore antagonism, the antagonism where insectivorous plants are represented, antagonism where herbivorous insects are represented, and commensalism and mutualism. All possible interactions are captured in this space. Now, so far, I tried to now cover one example each of all of them in this web of life example of coffee plantation I told so far. In the next session or in the next class, maybe day after tomorrow, I'll be now giving one example of this mutualism, which falls into the quadrant 4 in more detail, and tell you how such mutualistic interactions actually are leading to the ecosystem stability, which is the subject of this whole workshop. The web of life and the ecosystem stability. I'll be talking on that in the next class. So, Khan, I'm through.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
I will take this last part in the next session, but since there was time, I thought I'll cover it up.
Okay, sir. Participants, please, if you have any queries, please raise your hand. If not, you can put it in the chat box so that we can have the interaction with sir.
So no questions. So fine, Pan, I will say bye to all of you.
Thank you so much, sir, for joining with us. Thank you so much.
Okay. So see you on day after tomorrow.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Bye. Bye.
Sir, Absar sir, can you start sharing your screen, sir?
Yeah, I will share.
Aruna ma'am.
Yes, sir.
Yeah,
shall I introduce, sir?
Good afternoon. Ma'am, as soon as sir starts his sharing the screen, you can introduction. He's sharing the screen now.
Okay.
Yeah. Now you can start, ma'am.
Yes, sir. Good afternoon, everyone. It gives me immense pleasure to introduce Professor Absar Ahmed, who's Director of Interdisciplinary Nanotechnology Center from Aligarh Muslim University. And Professor Absar Ahmed, sir, has made pioneering and key contributions to the field of bio-nanoscience and technology, which have received high international acclaim amongst peers. And most notably, his entire volume of work has been developed and done in India. His work is noteworthy for its content of innovation and discovery based on imagination, keen observation, and application. It has an underlying theme of imaginative implementation of environmentally friendly green chemistry, room temperature, biological and bio-inspired methods to emerging areas of modern science with multidisciplinary applicability. In particular, he works on bio-inspired synthesis of metal, semiconductor and oxide nanosystems using fungal and plant extract media and related studies on exudation and control of biomolecular processes and mechanisms are highly cited. His recent works on anti-cancerous drug extraction from endophytic fungi and their immobilization on nanosystems for drug delivery applications are expected to have significant impact on emerging field of nanomedicine. He has co-authored many papers in high impact journals and has obtained a number of national and international patents. Professor Absar has been conferred with several prestigious awards, which include the DBT Tata Innovative Fellowship and VASIC Industrial Award, Materials Research Society of India Medal, CSIR National Chemical Laboratory, Scientists of the Year. And sir has total citations of more than 24,600, and the source is Google Scholar. And sir has around patents account to around 11, and he has contributed to book chapters of around 12. And sir has presented at international and national levels and symposia, which account to around 150. And we are very happy to have you here, sir, on the platform of virtual mode. And now I invite and welcome Professor Absar Ahmed, sir, to deliver his talk on the topic Biotechnology of Endophytic Fungi, Nanomaterials, and Future Drugs. Thank you, and over to you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you very much, ma'am, for a nice introduction.
Thank you, sir.
And first, I would like to thank the organizers, Dr. Haleem and other team members for giving this opportunity.
आपका video off है, sir.
Hello.
आपका video on कीजिए.
Video on. ठीक है. Video is on. You can.
नहीं सर, यहाँ पे red cross line दिखा रहा है.
अच्छा अच्छा. ठीक है.
हाँ अब ठीक है, आप शेयर करिए स्क्रीन.
ठीक है, अब आवाज आ रहा है?
जी आ रहा है.
ओके, थैंक यू वेरी मच. नाउ फर्स्ट आई वुड लाइक टू थैंक द ऑर्गेनाइजर डॉक्टर हलीम अब्दुल हलीम साहब एंड अदर मेंबर्स फॉर गिविंग मी दिस अपॉर्चुनिटी टू शेयर सम ऑफ अवर वर्क विच वी आर डूइंग ऑन नैनो साइंस एंड नैनो टेक्नोलॉजी फॉर द लास्ट 20 ईयर्स. I am going to talk on biotechnology of endophytic fungi, nanomaterials and future drugs. Aligarh Muslim University decided in 2016 to establish a state-of-the-art nanotechnology center with regard to the founder, such as his vision to harbor all new and novel fields of knowledge and research at Aligarh Muslim University. Having spent 23 years at CSIR NCL Pune, inclusive of 17 years of pioneering research work related to nanoscience and nanotechnology, I was invited by the Executive Council of AMU to help in establishing a world-class center of excellence in nanotechnology at the esteemed university. In view of the student welfare and knowledge propagation, I accepted the offer and joined Aligarh Muslim University in December 16 as the founder director of Nanotechnology Center. Since then, we have undertaken the teaching responsibilities of M.Tech Nanotechnology, Advanced PG Diploma in Nanotechnology, and now research in full swing. For the last 20 years, our group is mainly working on three areas: biosynthesis of nanomaterials using endophytic fungi, drugs from endophytic fungi, and recently we started the conjugation of drug to nanomaterials for targeted drug delivery. A range of nanomaterials and drugs we have made from endophytic fungi. What are endophytic fungi? They live inside the plant. They are not toxic. Daily we eat vegetables and fruit. They are full of endophytic fungi, but they are safe. They are not toxic. Therefore, we are using endophytic fungi for the synthesis of metal nanoparticle, bimetal nanoparticle, quantum dots, oxide, carbon, biominerals, etc. And this technology, we have made nanoparticle from the lemongrass, and this technology we have transferred to Tata Chemical. They are in use. A range of nanoparticle we have made, like metal, gold, silver, platinum, palladium, a range of bimetallic nanoparticle, quantum dots, a range of sulfide like zinc sulfide, nickel sulfide, cadmium sulfide, lead sulfide, a range of oxide like silica, everything from endophytic fungi. And Taxol is anti-cancer drug. Sorry. Till today, we are isolating from the bark of this tree. And this tree usually grow in Srinagar, where the temperature is very, very high. And this plant takes 100 years to grow. If you will harvest 100 years old plant, then you will get only 2 grams of the drug. So in order to provide the drug at low cost to the patients and low cost to the environment, I went to Srinagar and brought stem, leaves, fruit of this plant and isolated 40 fungi. Out of 40 fungi, one fungus is producing Taxol. So since we are making the nanomaterial in our lab, drugs in our lab, we made nanoparticle drug conjugate for targeted drug delivery. Screen is clear? Everything is clear? Hello? Hello?
Sir? Yeah.
Screen is clear, voice is clear.
Yeah, everything is clear, sir.
Thank you very much. A range of nanomaterial we have made in our lab, like silica, titania, zirconia, sulfide, quantum dots. And now we are screening our nanomaterials in healthcare. Healthcare means cancer, diabetes, malaria, Parkinson, and agriculture, how we can enhance the growth of the plant. And same nanomaterial we are screening in the energy. Energy means energy storage, energy conversion. Energy conversion means water splitting or you can say hydrogen generation and fuel cell, solar cell, and energy storage means battery supercapacitors. And our nanometrics are giving very good results in soil erosion, soil pollution, and soil, water, air, and all. And these nanoparticles are very important for the conversion of seawater into potable water. So we are getting very good results. And now, a range of nanomaterials and drug, mostly we are making from the endophytic fungi. They are safe, they are not toxic. And a daily we eat vegetables, fruit, they are full of endophytic fungi. If you will cut an apple, apple is full of around 20 or 30 type of fungi, but they are not toxic, they are safe. Therefore, we are using endophytic fungi only for the synthesis of nanomaterials and drugs. And recently we have isolated a range of nanomaterials from the mushroom also. These are edible mushroom, and we collected from the Himachal Pradesh. Dr. Lakhan Pal sir, he's the authority in that area. He's the father of mushroom in India. So I collected all the mushroom from Professor Lakhan Pal from Himachal Pradesh, and we are screening for the nanomaterials as well as drug. And some of the mushroom we have collected from the Kolhapur with the help of Dr. Patil. He is also authority on the mushroom. So he collected several mushroom. He handed over the mushroom to us, and we are screening this mushroom for the nanomaterials and drug. A range of mushroom we have collected from Kolhapur as well as from Himachal Pradesh. And this truffle is underground fungi, very tasty, but there is so far no reports of truffle from India. So we requested Professor Lakhan Pal sir. So he is helping because he has seen some truffles in Himachal Pradesh. Although these truffles are very, very important, but there is so far no reports of truffles from India because these are underground fungi. Only the trained pigs or dogs can detect the presence of these mushroom under the soil. India says India is a big country, but there are so far no reports of truffles from India. So we are interested to make a range of nanomaterials and drugs from the truffles also. And some mushroom are very toxic. This mushroom is edible, and this is toxic. How you can differentiate? Now, very simple method. You take mushroom extract, add hydrochloric acid. If you will get blue color, please don't eat that mushroom because this is full of amatoxin. The fungus, the person can die within half an hour. Now, most of the drug and nanomaterials we are isolating from endophytic fungi. Endophytic fungi, I think it is very, now everybody knows, but we have made pioneering contribution, and we started the work on endophytic fungi in the year 1986 when I was GRF. At that time, we isolated Balanchia, Atkinsonella, everything from some grasses and all. And after that, so many people are working on endophytic fungi. So endophytic fungi reside in a symbiotic fashion inside their host plants, mimic the chemistry of their respective host, and interestingly, produce the same bioactive natural product or drugs and derivatives as their host plants, meanwhile causing no damage to them. In addition to this, endophytes provide protection from insect pests and from overgrazing by animals. And isolation of endophytic fungi is very, very simple. This is Vinca rosea plant. And till today, everybody is isolating the vinblastin, vincristin from the leaves of this one. Our idea is that you isolate the endophytic fungi will produce the same bioactive compound which we are isolating from the leaves. So for the isolation of vinblastin, vincristin, we isolated several endophytic fungi from the leaves of Vinca rosea plant. The Vinca rosea is very, very important. Till today, we are isolating vinblastin, vincristin, which are very important drug for the chemotherapy. So isolation of endophytic fungi is very, 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 very easy. So we took the leaves and we washed the leaves with sterile distilled water and with some surfactants and put on the putative dextrose agar plant. You can see leaf pieces of Vinca rosea plant showing the emergence of endophytic fungi after 3 weeks. Any fungi which is coming after 2 or 3 days, please throw that one because they are not endophyte. Any fungi which you are getting after 3 weeks, 5 weeks, they are endophytic fungi. So they will produce the same thing. Like centaline, everybody is getting the centaloe album plant because because they are isolating centellin from the centellum album plant. Our idea is that if you can isolate the endophytic fungi will produce the same centellin. Then no need to cut the trees and all. We can save the biodiversity with the help of endophytic fungi. We have isolated around 52 endophytic fungi from the Vinca rosea plants, and we have given AACRL1 of Sar Ahmed isolated from the Catharinensis roseus leaf strain 1. So we have isolated several strains from the Vinca rosea plant, and out of 52 strain, only this fungus AACRL10 is producing wheat blast in Vinca strain. We have filed US patent also, and we have published a series of paper. One of my PhD student completed the PhD work, thesis work, and submitted the thesis, and we reported wheat blast in Vinca strain for the first time from the fungus, and that paper we have in PLOS ONE, and the citation of that paper has crossed around 200 today. So a range of drug we have made in our lab. In addition to wind blasting vincristine, we have also synthesized taxol, jasmonic acid, ergotic glide, plant growth regulators, everything from the endophytic fungi, and then we have made a range of nanomaterials from endophytic fungi. So now, what is nanotechnology? Nanotechnology is the study of manipulating matter on atomic and molecular scale. Who can work here? The doctors, engineers, zoologists, botanists, chemists, physicists, they can work together on nanos. It is interdisciplinary branch, and all the person from different fields can work on nanoscience and nanotechnology. Chemistry changes with the size. This is bulk gold, which is yellow in color. We use in the earrings, nose rings, and all, because this is very important for that point of view. But this bulk gold, which is yellow in color, chemically inert, can't convert the carbon monoxide into carbon dioxide. But the moment you will change the bulk into nano, it becomes very reactive. Nanomaterials are very important in healthcare, biotechnology, or you can say, then advanced material, catalysis, and so on. And this nano gold can convert the carbon monoxide into carbon dioxide. And nano sizing causes changes in color, conductivity, melting point, light absorption, crystal shape. You know, these are the gold nanoparticles of different sizes are showing different color. Gold is yellow in color, but if you will make 10 nanometer nanoparticle, you will get this color, 20 nanometer, 30 nanometer, 50, and so on. So it depends upon the size of the nanomaterial, you will get different colors of this one. Like carbon is black in color, but the moment you will make carbon nanomaterial, you may get the red color, purple color, orange color. This color depends upon the size of the nanomaterial. Like silver, these are the silver nanoparticles of different sizes are showing different color. CDSE nanoparticles of different sizes are showing different color. So see the strength. The moment you will change the bulk into nano, it's become very reactive. So can convert the carbon into carbon nanomaterial, gold into gold nanomaterial, silver into silver nanoparticle. And nanomaterials can be obtained by two methods, top-down method and bottom-up method. I will explain later on. And now I will come to application of nanomaterial. Like how you can target. Doxorubicin is a very important drug for the liver cancer. Suppose unfortunately somebody has the liver cancer. So doxorubicin is available in the market that is very effective for the liver cancer. The problem is that the patient takes this drug, it goes to liver, heart, and kidney. So people are getting renal toxicity and cardiotoxicity. So now we know the liver cancer overexpresses a protein. This is liver cancer, overexpresses a protein. The name of the protein is asialoglycoprotein, or you can say the receptor. This is proteination is in nature, 20 to 30 nanometer in size. So how we can target the doxorubicin? Because normal patient takes around 1.5 gram doxorubicin daily. So if you can target the doxorubicin to liver cancer, then you require only 15 or 20 milligram. You can imagine from gram to milligram. So for that, what we did in our lab, we made nanoparticle in our lab, and then we attached the drug. The name of the drug is doxorubicin. So we made nanoparticle drug conjugate, and then we attached the target molecule. This target molecule recognizes the receptor on the cancer. So receptor is asialoglycoprotein. So we made nanoparticle drug conjugate, and we attach the target molecule, injected into the penile vein of the rat, and then seen the biodistribution. You know, these whole complex, will come and bind to the receptor. We can kill the cancer with the help of this nanodoxilibicin, and we can heat the nanomaterial. This is known as hyperthermia of the cancer, because our body temperature is 37. If we can enhance the temperature from 37 to 42, that is sufficient to treat the tumorous growth. And in addition to that, nanoparticles are very important in catalysis, homogeneous catalysis, heterogeneous catalysis, as precursor for synthesis for coating of electronic application in hyperthermia of the cancer. And we can use the nanoparticle in the biosensor, environmental sensor, detection of the poisonous substances in the soil. And these are very important in drug delivery, targeted drug delivery in diagnostics and so on. So now nanoparticles are very, very important. You know, nanoparticles are showing insect repellent activity. A range of insects we took, and nanoparticles are repelling the insect, means nanoparticles are showing repellent activity. A range of nanoparticles like silica, titania, zirconia, gadolinium, and now nanoparticles can enhance the growth of the plants, and we can treat a range of plant diseases with the help of nanomaterial. So our nanoparticles may increase plant growth and vigor, enhancement of tilling growth, greater seed scent, and nanoparticles can provide antifungal activity, antibacterial activity, antiviral activity, and so on. And now with the help of nanomaterial, David et al. Published a paper in Nature. He made positively charged silica nanomaterial, and he took the DNA. DNA is negatively charged. He made nanoparticle DNA conjugate and injected into the plant to see the distribution and all. And because now one can deliver the DNA, we can make transgenic. We don't require agrobacterium now. We can directly transform. We can make transgenic with the help of nanomaterial. So now one can deliver the DNA with the help of nanomaterial. This will help in future investigations of plant genomics and gene function, as well as improvement of the crops. And similarly, Maria et al., she took different carbon material, activated carbon, graphene, multi-wall graphene, and then they saw the effect on the tomato plant. And she reported very good enhancement of the tomato plant with the help of multi-walled carbon nanotube. And now similarly, we can treat a range of dental problem with the help of nanomaterial. Everybody is interested only in such type of teeth. And you may get such type of teeth if you can check the fungal infection. You know, these are orthodontic appliances. The moment you will put on the teeth, and the moment you will remove after 1 month, the moment you will remove this orthodontic appliances, then you will get the bacterial growth. And now this bacterial growth we can check with the help of nanomaterial. And similarly, nanoparticle with the help of nanomaterial, we can treat a range of eye diseases with the help of nanomaterial. Earlier, it was very, very difficult to control the eye diseases, but because of this barrier, and now our nanoparticles are crossing to this barrier, and we can treat a range of, this is retina portion. This portion is very, very difficult to control, but now we can attach the drug onto the nanomaterial. The size is very, very less, and we can deliver the drug for the retina also. And then same nanoparticle which we are using in healthcare, agriculture, same nanoparticle we are using in the construction industry, like solar panel, then bridge formation, then coating on the silica and all. And now a range of big companies like Xerox, Baxter, and Amazon, then AMD, Hitachi, Procter & Gamble, Nokia, they're working on nanoscience and nanotechnology. If you are going to work on nanoscience and nanotechnology, you have to make nanomaterials. Nanomaterials can be obtained by physical method, chemical method, biological method. I'm going to concentrate my talk only on the biological synthesis of nanomaterial. Hello. Slides are clear, no problem?
Yeah, sir, they are fine, sir.
Okay, thank you. Now, this TM is very, very important, because nanoparticle synthesis is very, very easy, but the characterization of the nanomaterials are very, very tough. So this TM, transmission electron microscope, is very, very important for the characterization of the nanomaterial. This instrument is available at Aligarh Muslim University, and this instrument was available at NCL Pune. So we are very fortunate. Nanoparticle synthesis is very, very tough. All the audience who are listening my lecture, they can work on nanoscience and nanotechnology next day. But the characterization is very costly. we required very, very costly instrument for the characterization of the nanomaterial. And fortunately, all the instruments related to nanotechnology characterization are available at Aligarh Muslim University. And they are also available where I worked. I worked in NCL Pune. And you will get all the nanoparticle characterization instrument at NCL Pune also. So if anybody is interested to visit our center, they are most welcome. They can visit our center. They can work in our center because we have all the instruments for related to nanotechnology that is available at our center. And now these instruments are very, very important for the characterization of the nanomaterial like UV visible spectroscopy, FTIR, X-ray diffraction, X-ray photoemission spectroscopy, energy dispersive analysis of the X-rays, transmission electron microscopy, scanning electron microscopy, and selected radio electron diffraction pattern. These instruments are very, very important for the characterization of the nanomaterial. And fortunately, I told in the beginning, we are fortunate enough to have all the instruments at our center. And now, why biosynthetic approach to nanomaterial synthesis? Nanomaterials can be obtained by physical and chemical method, but these methods are hazardous, eco-friendly, cumbersome, yield big particles. Therefore, there is a growing need for reliable and economic synthesis of nanomaterial. Nanomaterial, which we are making from the fungus and plants, they are water dispersible. They are not toxic, they are safe. If the size of nanoparticle is 10 nanometer today, if you will see after 1 year, you will get 10 nanometer because our nanoparticles are capped by protein. They don't flocculate. The size is remain constant for 1 year or more than 1 year. They are not toxic. So you know all the nanoparticle work I started on the basis of this reaction. These micro endophytic microorganisms convert the cyclohexanone to cyclohexanol. This is reduction reaction. And same microorganism converts the cyclohexanone to caprolactone. This is oxidation reaction. So these microorganisms do the redox reaction. The nanoparticle, the fungi which give the redox reaction are very, very important for the nanomaterial synthesis. A range of 110 paper, 2,500,000 citation, because of this reaction. I thought when the fungus can reduce organic compound like cyclohexanone, why not inorganic compound? So instead of cyclohexanone, I took silver nitrate and fungus converted the silver nitrate into silver nanoparticle. Then I took gold solution and fungus converted the gold solution into gold nanoparticle. This is a mechanism. All over the world, people are following our method. Wherever I deliver the talk, people have started the work on nanoscience and nanotechnology. The work on the biosynthesis, we have made pioneering contribution all over the world, America, Japan, London, everywhere people are following our method. This method I developed in 2001 when I was in NCL Pune. And now the same, we have Aligarh, I joined in December 2016, and we are making all the types of nanoparticle. We have a separate center. And you all are welcome to visit our center. You can learn the nanotechnology. So nanotechnology, the future science, it is very, very important. And the nanoparticle which we are making from the fungus and plant, they are protein cap. They are water dispersible. We can attach peptide, protein, DNA, RNA, because they are capped by protein. And now we can reduce the weight of, we can reduce the size of the nano further with the help of biomimicking method. Selectively bioleaching, monodisperse, different shape and size of the nanomaterial. Now I will come to intracellular nanoparticle. This is verticillium growing in water, and here it is growing in gold solution. Initially it was yellow in color. Now the color of biomass injection plus is changed from white to purple color, which clearly indicates the formation of gold nanoparticle intracellularly. If you feel the, now we know the mechanism, how the fungus convert the gold into gold nanoparticle. Now we have published the mechanism. Fungus secretes NADPH. Fungus secretes the enzyme. So if you have the gold solution means you have the gold ions in the flask. Now the fungus convert the gold ions into gold nanoparticle. What is the mechanism? Fungus secretes NADPH. In the biological system, electrons comes from NADPH. So fungus secretes the NADPH. The NADPH gives 3 electrons to enzyme. NADPH will oxidize. Enzyme will reduce. Now the enzyme gives 3 electrons to gold ions and convert gold ions into gold zero. Gold zero means gold nanoparticle. So now we have different instrument for the characterization of that one. And if you will filter this flask, the filtrate is colorless, biomass is colored. But now we made ultrasound in order to see the exact location of nanoparticle inside the set. We made ultrasound section of this fungal biomass and then observed under the transmission electron microscopy. This is a single fungal cell, and nanoparticles are present inside the cell as well as on the cell wall. And we have completely characterized by different methods like UV, XRD, TEM, and all. These intracellular nanoparticles are very, very important for drug delivery in coating electronics and several in the catalysis and so on. And now this is a method how we made ultrasound section, and this is fungal cell. What is the mechanism? Nanoparticles are formed on the inner surface as well as on the outer surface. Here, trapping of ions on the surface of the fungal and actinomycete cell. Here, ions are reduced. Gold ions, silver ions are reduced by the enzyme reductases present in the cell wall or in the cytoplasm. So now, it took around 8 years to give the mechanism. We have published the mechanism in RSC Advances. I will show the paper. If anybody is interested to know the mechanism, they can refer to that paper that we published in 2014. Now I will come to extracellular nanoparticle synthesis. This is the fungus growing in water. Here the fungus is growing in gold solution. Initially it was yellow in color. Now the color of biomass injection flask is changed from white to ruby red color, which clearly indicates the formation of gold nanoparticle. In order to see whether the particles are extracellular or intracellular, we filtered both the flasks, and upon filtration, aqueous solution of the control flask was colorless, and upon filtration, aqueous solution of the treated flask showed ruby red color, which clearly indicates the formation of gold nanoparticle extracellularly. And now we took a small portion of this one, put on the TM, and then saw under the TM, and you can see this is TM micrograph of drop coated film of gold nanoparticle synthesized extracellularly. Nanoparticle uniform in size, because in our lab we used to keep the size 2 to 50 nanometer, because our kidney can filter up to 50 nanometer. So most of the nanoparticle which we are making in our lab, we used to keep the size 20 to 50 nanometer. They can deliver the drug and they will pass from the kidney, then toxicity is not a problem. We have another fungus. This fungus is producing different shape and size of the nanomaterial. You can see they are highly separated. The shelf life is very high because they don't flocculate. Your triangular nanoparticle, hexagonal nanoparticle, they don't flocculate, they are capped by protein. The dispersity is very high, chemically, physically very difficult to make such type of nanomaterial. And now these nanoparticles I am using for the targeted delivery of the liver cancer. So what we did, we tested the toxicity of these nanomaterial on the cancer cell line and normal cell line, and then we radiolabeled with technetium, injected into the penile vein of the rat to see the biodistribution. This is a rat, you know, this is gamma scintigraphic image of biodistribution of gold nanoparticle in the rat. You can see these nanoparticles which are circular and all, when we radiolabeled with technetium, injected into the rat to see the biodistribution, these nanoparticles are going to liver and passing from the urine. Why they are passing from the urine? Because our kidney can filter up to 50 nanometer. And here the sizes are 2 to 25 nanometer. That's why they are passing from the urine. So these nanoparticles are very important for the targeted drug delivery, advanced material and so on. And they will not cause toxicity. Then we took doxorubicin. That is very effective drug for the liver cancer. Then we conjugated with nanomaterial. You can see after the conjugation, the fluorescence will quench. And now I have made whole complex. I have attached doxorubicin gold conjugate. We attached the target molecule and we supplied to Amla cancer, and they are working in that area. So we are very good. We are getting very good results for the treatment of the liver cancer. And now we know the mechanism. I told in the beginning, after 8 years, we got the mechanism. Here, this is gold solution. In the gold solution, we added capping protein, this capping protein, molecular weight is 13 kD. When we added NADPH and we added this enzyme, when we added everything, then we are getting 3 to 5 nanometer nanoparticle. And if you will not add this capping protein, you will get 100 nanometer. So this mechanism, I took around 8 years. my student published the thesis after 8 years because that was very complicated work. And after 8 years, we came to know and we know the mechanism why the fungus converts the gold into gold nanoparticle and silver into silver nanoparticle. And then we met silver nanoparticle. Very, very simple reaction. The fungus is growing in water. Here the fungus is growing in silver nitrate solution. Initially it was colorless, but the now color of biomass induction plasma is changed from white to dark brown, which clearly indicates the formation of extracellular silver nanoparticle. And we have completely characterized, and these silver nanoparticle, which I made from the fungus, that is giving very good antifungal activity against Aspergillus niger. That is very important discovery. And we have published this paper in Spectrochemica, that very important journal. We have completely characterized the nanomaterial. And after that, a range of mushroom which I collected from Himachal Pradesh. These mushroom we use for the synthesis of range of nanomaterial. Very simple reaction we did. This is mushroom. This is gold solution. We made mushroom extract. We added into the gold solution. Mushroom extract converted the gold solution into gold nanoparticles. And these nanoparticles are very, very important for the cancer, other activities and all. We have completely characterized with the help of different techniques. And this is TM micrograph of the gold nanoparticle synthesized from this mushroom cancerillus. This mushroom is very, very important. Again, this mushroom I collected from the Himachal Pradesh. This is thanks to Dr. Lakhan Pal sir. And after another Volitus, he also supplied me this mushroom. And this mushroom, I took mushroom extract, added into the gold solution. Mushroom extract converted the gold solution into gold nanoparticle. And then I took mushroom extract and then added into silver nitrate solution. This mushroom extract converted silver nitrate into silver nanoparticle. And this is TM micrograph. Chemically, physically, very difficult to make different shape and size of the nanomaterial. But now we are working on the mechanism, how this mushroom is synthesizing nanoparticle, different shapes and size of the nanomaterial. It is very, very difficult, chemically, physically, very difficult to make different shape and size of the nanomaterial. And now another group is working how we can purify all the nanoparticles from this extract, because we are getting triangular, hexagonal, ribbon shape, and rectangular. All the shapes we are getting, that is because of the different capping protein. Fungus secretes a range of capping proteins and all. So different shapes you are getting because of different capping proteins. And now after the another fungus, you can see this fungus, we made the extract. This fungus is also producing silver nanoparticle and gold nanoparticle. Another, I think everybody is aware of this one. This is Ganoderma. It is very important for the treatment of so many diseases. That mushroom is available only on the rainy season. Again, this mushroom I got from Dr. C.R. Patil. He's from Kolhapur. And this mushroom is also producing gold and silver nanoparticle. And this mushroom is producing triangular nanoparticle, hexagonal nanoparticle, rod-shaped nanoparticle. We have completely characterized. And then after that, I went to Goa, NIO Goa. From there, we collected Tetrasalmis cochinensis. That is algae. And that algae I brought from the Goa. And then again, we took the algae and we added the gold solution. Algae converted the gold solution into gold nanoparticle. But here the nanoparticles are intracellular. They are inside the cell. Again, this paper we published in Material Letters in 2012. And then we got another algae. This algae is producing extracellular gold nanoparticle. Very simple reaction. We took algae. We had some chlorella and chlorella oscillatoria. And then we added into the gold solution. And chlorella and oscillatoria converted this into gold nanomaterial. And we have completely characterized. This is TM micrograph. You can see how the algae is producing different shape and size of the nanomaterial. The Li nanoparticles are very, very important. Chemically, physically, very difficult to make a Li. We did a very simple reaction. We took gold solution, silver nitrate solution, added 60 gram of the fungus Fusarium oxysporum, and fungus Fusarium oxysporum converted the gold solution and silver nitrate solution into AuAgLi nanoparticle. This gold nanoparticle gives the absorbance at 5 to 550 nanometer, and silver nanoparticle give the absorbance at 4 to 450 nanometer. You know, we took gold solution, silver nitrate solution, reacted with 60 grams of the fungus and kept for 96 hours. After 24 hours, gold and silver give more purple color, and after 48 hours less purple color, after 72 hours less brown color, and after 96 hours dark brown color. The gradual change of color from purple to deep brown is the clear indicative of the formation of bimetallic AuAg nanoparticle. Chemically, physically, very, very difficult. And this paper we have published in small, very high impact factor journal. And the platinum nanoparticles are very, very important for the cancer. I took only this one, chloroplatinic acid, because I'm a microbiologist. For the last 20 years, I am working on the nano. So I have fungus which does oxidation. I have the fungus which does reduction. I have the fungus which does methylation. I have the fungus which does hydrolysis. The range of fungi I have, where I have to use, how I have to use this, I learned at NCL Pune. And now I know, when I took chloroplatinic acid, that is the salt which I purchased from the Sigma. So I use the fungus with the reduction. So fungus converted the chloroplatinic acid into platinum nanoparticle. We have completely characterized, and these platinum nanoparticles are very, very important for the cancer treatment. And after that, I have made a range of sulfide. Quantum dross nanoparticle, very simple method. I took cadmium sulfate, and when we added the fungus, and fungus converted the cadmium sulfate into cadmium sulfide, that is yellow in color. And these cadmium sulfides are highly fluorescent in nature, and they are very, very important for the diagnostics and imaging. We have completely characterized, and this paper we have very simple reaction. I took only cadmium sulfate. I added the fungus with the reduction only. So just the cadmium sulfate, if you will take in the water, it will break into cadmium 2 plus SO4 minus. And now the fungus convert the cadmium ion into cadmium 0, and then SO4 into SO0 and SO0 and CD0. They are coming together and forming CDS nanoparticle. This paper I have published in one of the best journal in chemistry. The name of the journal is Journal of American Chemical Society. The impact factor is around 14. A range of sulfide we have made, like we made CDT nanoparticle. They are highly fluorescent in nature, very important for the imaging and diagnosis. And this CDSC nanoparticles are giving very good antibacterial activity against a range of gram-positive bacterium and gram-negative bacterium. And now copper aluminum oxide nanoparticle. Chemically, people are making at 1100 degrees centigrade under inert condition. It takes 4 days. Then somebody from the USA, he visited my lab. He requested me, that Professor Ahmed, can you make copper aluminum oxide nanoparticle? I told, what is the fun? They told, we are making at 1100 degrees centigrade under inert condition. It takes 4 days. We did a very simple reaction. We took two salt, copper nitrate, aluminum nitrate, reacted with the fungus, and you will not believe the reaction which they are doing at 1100 degrees centigrade. I did only room temperature, from 1100 degrees centigrade to room temperature. And that paper we communicated to Advanced Material. The impact factor is above 28. And this is TM micrograph of copper aluminum oxide nanomaterial. They're highly fluorescent in nature, very important for the imaging, very important for the diagnostic, and very important in advanced material, case analysis, and so on. And then range of oxide, like silica oxide, titanium oxide, zirconium oxide, magnetite, barium titanate, everything we made from the fungus. Barium titanate, NCL, I have seen people used to make at 1800 degrees centigrade, 1800, 1800. And again, we made barium titanate. We took two salt, barium acetate, and K2TiF6, reacted with the fungus, and you will not believe, the fungus immediately converted barium acetate and K2TiF6 into barium titanate nanomaterial at room temperature. From 1800 to room temperature, remarkable result. And immediately when we reported barium titanate, we communicated the paper to Journal of American Chemical Society. The paper accepted in 2 weeks. And these particles are very, very important for the microelectronics. But we have made a room temperature only, instead of 1800 to room temperature. And then we have made a range of biomineral in our lab. Actually, I went to Nottingham. Peter Kolesh is the expert in that area. I spent 2 or 3 days in Peter Kolesh's lab in Nottingham. And then I came to know she is making a range of biomineral. Biomineral means calcium carbonate, strontium carbonate. Then I talked to Peter Kolesh. I told, madam, how you was making? She took, I take only calcium chloride. The moment you will take the calcium chloride, it will break into calcium ion plus chloride ion, and then this calcium binds with the protein which she used to purchase from the sigma, anionic protein from the sigma. She used to make calcium protein complex, and the carbon dioxide exhaled from the carbon dioxide, and she bubbled from the cylinder, and she made calcium carbonate, nano calcium carbonate. Then I thought fungus secrete the protein. Fungal exhale. The moment I landed at Delhi airport, I went to Pune. I called my student, just bring calcium chloride. He brought the calcium chloride. I added the fungus. I know the fungus secretes anionic protein, and fungal exhale the carbon dioxide. I took the advantage of this feature, and I took calcium chloride, added the fungus, and fungus converted the calcium chloride into nano calcium carbonate. And that paper we published in one of the best journal in chemistry, Journal of American Chemical Society. After that, we made a range of biominerals in our lab. We took only a calcium chloride, fungus converted the calcium chloride into calcium carbonate, strontium chloride into strontium carbonate, barium chloride into barium carbonate. A range of biominerals I have made, very simple reaction. This is a micrograph of the calcium carbonate from the fungus Fusarium oxysporum. We have made different shape and size of the calcium carbonate, strontium carbonate, barium carbonate from the fungus and from the plant extract. And lead toxicities and cadmium toxicities are very, very common in the drinking water. So what we did, just we took cadmium chloride, we converted the cadmium chloride into cadmium carbonate, and lead chloride, lead nitrate into lead carbonate. This carbonate, they are not toxic. So we are interested to convert the toxic chemicals into non-toxic one. And this paper we have in Langmuir, and we know the mechanism also. And after that, we made porous carbon. Porous carbon, we took the fungus, and we calcined the fungus. After calcination, fungus made porous carbon of 2 to 5 nanometer. Our idea is that this is a porous carbon. This is the SEM micrograph of this one, the size of 2 to 5 nanometer. Our idea is that if you will take seawater, you will get the fungus, bacteria, actinomycete, heavy metal, salt, viruses, you will get everything. Our idea is that if you will just pass this one glass of the water through our porous material, you can directly convert the seawater into potable water. Very, very, very simple method and very, very important discovery. And we are going to file a patent, and then we can directly convert the seawater into potable water with the help of our porous material. A range of nanomaterial which we have made, they are very, like we have made porous carbon. I took actually graphite. And a fungus, I took fungus converted the graphite into graphene oxide into graphene to porous graphene to graphene quantum dots. A range of nanoparticles we have made, they are very, very important for the energy storage, very, very important for the energy conversion. We made porous carbon, and you can see we can light an LED with the help of nanomaterial. So we are using these porous material as a supercapacitor. And you can see one of my friend, he's my collaborator. He showed me your nanoparticles are working as a supercapacitor. And now I just, a range of silica we have made. You know, silica is a very important material. And only Degussa is making silica. And they have the monopoly. If you have write a letter today, they will supply after 2 weeks. And then I was very upset. I wrote a letter to Degussa. We are interested to purchase Sigma. They don't know. We will take 3 to 4 months. I was very disturbed. Then I came to home at Pune. I took my scooter and I went to different construction site in order to collect the sand. Sand is made up of so many oxide like silica, titania, zirconia, and all. I, as a microbiologist, I know my bio-leaching. So I could not get the sand. Then I went to Lucknow. Lucknow is my home place. I was passing from the river Gomti. I collected some sand from the river Gomti and added the fungus. And you will not believe the fungus, because sand is made up of so many oxide, silica, titania, zirconia, and so on. The moment I added the fungus selectively isolated only silica nanomaterial. And this is control sand, and this is treated sand. Here the surface control sand, here the surface is smooth, and here the surface is rough. This rough surface is because of leaching of silica nanomaterial. This paper again published in Advanced Material. The impact factor is above 28. Then rice husk, if you will pluck any rice leaf or sugarcane leaf, you may cut your finger. This cut is because of amorphous, a knife-like structure present onto the sugarcane leaf or some leaves, and you cut your finger because of this one. So fungus first leaches this amorphous silica and convert amorphous silica into crystalline silica. This paper again we have published in JAX, one of the best journal in chemistry. And then I will come to plant part also, because fungus takes 4 to 5 days to grow, then you are isolating nanomaterial. We thought, can we isolate nanoparticle as fast as the chemical method? I did my PhD on the lemongrass. I isolated a fungus, that fungus was producing triangular nanoparticle, but it takes around 6, 7, 8 days. Then I thought, endophytic fungus, now I will see some plant. I screened a range of plant for metal salt reduction. So plants have been found to reduce the metal ions and lead to subsequent formation of nanoparticles extracellularly as fast as the chemical method. So actually, this is the lemongrass extract. This is the gold solution. We did a very simple reaction. We made gold colloid. This is lemongrass extract, and we added into the gold solution, and this lemongrass extract converted the gold solution into gold nanoparticle. And then we added lemongrass extract into silver nitrate solution. Fungus converted the silver nitrate into silver nanoparticle. And this is TM. And here we got nanoparticle in only 30 seconds. And this is TM micrograph of the gold nanoparticle synthesized with the help of lemongrass. And here the triangular nanoparticle, you can see this TM micrograph of this one. The triangular nanoparticle gives the absorbance at NIR region, very, very important for the hyperthermia of the cancer. The citation of this, and this paper we have published in Nature Material, the impact factor is around 40. And the citation has crossed around 1800. So this is a very, very important discovery, because we made the nanoparticle only in 30 seconds. And now we can make different shape and size of the nanomaterial with the help of percolative multi-cavity synthesis. And this method I will explain later on. And now our nanoparticle bismuth sulfide, which I made, they are highly fluorescent in nature. So they can work as a MRI contrast agent and CT contrast agent. You can see, till today people are using gadolinium oxide for the MRI contrast, but the cost is around 5,000 rupees. And if you will compare the contrast, you can see our nanoparticles are giving very good contrast as compared to gadolinium oxide. And same nanoparticle is working as a MRI contrast. So these are very, very important discoveries. So we have a nanomaterial which we can use in the MRI contrast agent and CT contrast agent. And this is a biodistribution of bismuth sulfide nanoparticle. And same, we have developed the Parkinson in the rat with the help of drug. And finally, we are treating the Parkinson with the help of cerium oxide nanomaterial. This you can check with the help of behavior of the rat. If the rat is normal, it will move slowly. But the moment you will develop the Parkinson, it run very fast in the jar. And so now we induce the Parkinson with the help of some drug, OSDA, and then we use cerium oxide nanoparticle, and we are treating the Parkinson. And similarly, our nanoparticles are giving very good GLUT4 transmigration. So that activity is very, very important. Or you can say our nanoparticles are giving and a very good anti-diabetic activity. Activity is better than the insulin. And similarly, our nanoparticles are giving very good anti-malaria activity. And recently, one of our collaborators, I gave around 30 types of nanomaterial, and he reported me that this circular nanoparticle I gave, and these circular nanoparticles are inhibiting HIV virus. This is control virus. And when you incubate the virus with nanoparticle, they go and then, you know, the virus they have, how virus multiply? Virus has GB120 glycoprotein. The size of the GB120 glycoproteins are around 35, 40 nanometer. So now we made nanoparticle. The moment you will incubate, the nanoparticle will bind to GB120 glycoprotein. And after binding, viruses can't multiply. So that is very, very important method. And we are getting around 81% inhibition with the help of nanomaterial. Our idea is that these nanoparticles, which I made from the lemongrass, they absorb the heat. Means we can dissolve the cholesterol when no need for angiography, angioplasty, and no need for stent and all. These nanoparticles will dissolve the cholesterol, and you can spend a healthy life. Now, after the angiogenesis, development of new blood vessels, our same nanoparticle, you know, this I took two eggs, and in one egg we added water, another egg we added nanoparticle, and we kept for 24 hours. After 24 hours, where we added the water, angiogenesis is not taking place. Angiogenesis means development of new blood vessels. And the, where we added water, the angiogenesis is taking place. So that is very important. We can treat a range of heart diseases with the help of this nanoparticle. And now, cancer cell migration. You know, we give the cancer cell line in petri plate, breast cancer cell line in petri plate. And now we took two plates and we made the wound with the help of pipette. In one petri plate, we added water. Another petri plate, we added a silver nanoparticle and kept for 24 hours. After 24 hours, where we added water, the cancer cells are migrating, and where we added silver nanoparticle, cancer cells are not migrating, indicating its remarkable potential to be developed as an anti-metastatic drug. And now a range of drug, I told in the beginning, a range of drug we are isolating from endophytic fungi, like Taxol, that we have isolated. Taxol is a, this is a structure of the Taxol, and till today we are isolating from the bark of this one. Our idea is that if you will isolate endophytic fungi, the endophytic fungi will produce the same Taxol. And now we isolated 40 fungi from this plant. Out of 40 fungi, one fungus is producing Taxol. We have completely characterized. One of my PhD students got the PhD in Taxol, and we published several papers. And we have characterized, completely characterized the Taxol. And after that, we made vinblastin, vincristin. We isolated this fungus is producing vinblastin, vincristin. Any plant compound you can isolate from the endophytic fungi. But isolation of endophytic fungi is very, very tough. If any fungi is coming after 1 day, 2 day, 3 day, throw that one because they are not endophytic fungi. So if you want to isolate the same biopsy compound from the fungus, you have to wait for endophytic fungi. We have completely characterized another trichocycin, trichocycinol we have isolated. And now our idea is that any plant compound, like any plant compound you can isolate from endophytic fungi and all, and it is very easy, not very tough. So we are making nanoparticle in our lab, and we are making drug in our lab. We made nanoparticle drug conjugate for targeted drug delivery. And now the last part of my talk is that we have made a range of nanoparticles that are showing anti-diabetic activity, anti-malarial activity, theranostic, anti-HIV activity, anti-cancer activity. We can improve the growth of the plant. We can deliver the DNA, and we can make transgenic, and nanoparticles are giving antifungal, antifungal activity, anti-insect activity, and so on. And now we have already published several papers, outstanding paper. Now the time has come. Now I came to Aligarh in order to translate our basic science into process, product, and technology. My group until now has several positive leads for valuable drugs from endophytes and role of bioinspired nanomaterials in imaging and diagnostics and for the treatment or control of diabetes, malaria, HIV, cancer, leishmania, neurodegenerative disorder, etc., as evident by our publication in peer-reviewed journals. In order to translate all of the above socio-friendly research into usable product in near future, the expertise, infrastructure, and facilities available at AMU may play a prime role. Once a successful collaboration is established, we will together be able to introduce these valuable product and services to the masses at very affordable price and in abundance. And now we are grateful to our Vice Chancellor, Professor Tariq Mansoor Sahab, for encouraging our work on nanoscience and nanotechnology. We are grateful to our staff, our research scholar, our technical staff, and our coordinator for research and other activities. With this, I conclude my talk. Thank you very much. If you have any question, I am very happy to give the answers and all.
Sir, in chat box, there are a few questions, sir.
Yeah, please, most welcome.
Sir, there is a first question by Dr. Das. he asked, how can we separate endophytic fungi from plants?
Separate isolation, na? So that's why you take the leaves, bark the leaves. Suppose wind blasting, wind kissing, we are isolating from the leaves of this one. So you take the leaves, wash the leaves with water and wash the leaves with some surfactants and cut into pieces, and these pieces put on the potato dextrose agar and wait for 2 or 3 weeks. And if you are getting any growth after, if you are getting one growth in 1 or 2 days, they are not endophytic fungi. 2 or 3 days, they are not endophytic fungi. If you can observe any growth after 3 weeks, 4 weeks, 5 weeks, they are endophytic fungi, and you can separate that one.
Then next question is, how can we know whether they are toxic or not?
Which one? Toxic? Yeah.
The endophytes are there.
Now you can send the sample to IITR, Indian Institute of Toxicological Research. They will immediately, they will charge some money and they will tell you that your fungus is not toxic. You know? So you have to send to Indian Institute of Toxicological Research, IITR, or some other lab in Pune. So they will do some mycotoxin assay, and they will tell you your microorganism are grass-killed organism, no toxicity. Isolate and send to IITR, isolate and send to some lab in the Mumbai Pune. You will get within 2 or 3 days.
And
there
is a question that what is actually fungus doing in synthesis of nanoparticles? Whether it is doing oxidation of metal or any other mechanism, it will also perform.
Yeah, yeah. So I told in the beginning, okay, now after 8 years rigorous training and all, and our research scholar worked very hard, I told fungus, like we have the gold solution. Gold solution means yellow color. The gold solution, if you will take in water, they are in gold ions, Au plus 3 ions. So fungus secretes NADPH. NADPH gives the electrons. So fungus, kya karta? Fungus secretes NADPH, fungus secretes enzyme. So if you have the gold ions, so fungus immediately secretes NADPH. NADPH gives 3 electrons to enzyme. NADPH will oxidize, enzyme will reduce. Now enzyme gives 3 electrons to gold ions and convert gold ions into gold nanoparticle. Gold nanoparticle means gold zero. And this you can confirm with the help of machine. The name of the machine is X-ray photoemission spectroscopy. You can clear the mechanism. Like gold, silver, we know the mechanism of everything. As a biologist, we should know the mechanism. What is the mechanism? How fungus converts the silver nitrate into silver nanoparticle? Same mechanism. NADPH, fungus secretes NADPH. NADPH gives 1 electron to enzyme. Enzyme gives 1 electron to silver ions and converts silver plus to silver zero. Silver zero means nanoparticle. And you will get the color also. Depend upon the size, you will get different shape and different size produces different colors.
So what is the last question asked by participant is about the status of nanoparticle therapy in India.
Now people are trying, several people took the nanoparticle from me and they are getting some results. Actually, that is very important for the cancer. I told in the beginning, the nanoparticle which I made from the plant of lemongrass, they absorb the heat. And our body temperature is 37. If we can enhance the temperature from 37 to 42, that is sufficient to kill the tumorous growth. So that is very good. Now, very soon you will get some results and all. Because we are very, very much excited on the because HIV and all, one of the most dreaded disease is cancer. So we are working on that because that is now nanoparticle. We will use nanoparticle as a future drug. We don't require any drug. Nanoparticle itself will work as a drug.
About one question from my side is, the endophytes are considered as to be, they will get their gene from the host by horizontal gene transfer.
This you are very clear, but nobody could prove till today. We know the fungus which we isolated from Texas, Vinca rosea, that is producing wind blasting, wind kissing. But the same fungus, when we isolated the plant which is available at Maharashtra, we are not getting wind blasting, wind kissing from the leaves of this one. We don't know whether the genes are going from the fungus to the plant or plant to the fungus. So we are working, if you can work in that direction, if you can prove that now genes are going from the fungus to the plant or plant to the fungus, that will be a major breakthrough and you can publish the paper Nature or Science. Till today, nobody has proved that. We know. But whether the genes are going from the fungus to the plant or plant to the fungus, if you are interested in that area, that is wonderful study.
And one more question is, whether these whatever horizontally transferred gene we are expecting, how long? Because when we are going for transgenic studies, we have come to know that after some generation passing, they may lose the gene or they may not be able to have the desired activity. So what about endophytes? Endophytes, how long endophytes will say whether they will become industrial proven strain to produce a metabolite particularly?
That's why the like I made Taxol, Vinblastine, Taxol. For the last 10 years, we have a guru is working on Taxol and we are getting the same concentration. Up to 50, 60 generation, we are getting the same thing. Our strain is very, very stable. And for the 10 years, we are getting the same 15, 20 microgram per liter when we started in 2012. Till today, we are getting the same unit. So our strain, on the basis of that, we can say our strains are highly stable. And one can enhance the quantity from microgram to gram also. When the penicillin was isolated, at that time the penicillium chrysogenum was producing only 1 nanogram per liter. After 1 nanogram to 100 nanogram, 100 nanogram to milligram, milligram to gram, gram to 10 milligram, 10 kilogram. And now the same strain is producing the 25 gram per liter of that penicillin. So we can do such type of thing. As a microbiologist, nothing is impossible.
Participants, please, if you can have any more queries, please, you can either raise the hand or you can put in the chat box as a few questions has been asked. We have a rare opportunity to meet sir, because while he was in NCL, he was too busy. I think he was not having any, he was full of assignments. Now, I think we could see he could be available for us in our refresher course. It is a rare opportunity. Really, we should thank Manohar Achari sir, who was the person behind getting sir for our refresher course. Really, participants, please, if you have any query regarding endophytes or nanoparticles or nanomaterials, please, you can put in the chat box.
Please, I will be happy to give the answer. Please clear everything. Anything related to nanotechnology or drug, whatever you want, you can clear. And even though you can take my number, you can take my phone number, email address, you can correspond. Or if you are interested to learn on the drug and nanomaterial, you are most welcome to visit our center after COVID.
Tari sir, are you there in the meeting?
Yeah, I am here.
So you can acknowledge Absar Ahmed sir for his presentation.
Yeah. Namaskar sir, kaise hain sir, how are you?
Namaskar, fine, thank you.
I am grateful to you and you have given a chance to me to discuss.
No, you deserve.
And visit sir, I will invite you to Aligarh also. I am very happy sir is, I know sir for the last so many years and sir is very grateful to us. He's very cooperative and I am very grateful to sir for giving me this opportunity to share some of my work on nanoscience. Thank you very much, sir.
So really dear participants and faculty, Dr. Absar Ahmed is known for his simplicity. He's known for his concerted efforts in making the research a productive research. And Dr. Absar Ahmed is known for his practicality. He doesn't believe in theory, but he believes in getting the things done for the human welfare. And here is the aspect that he has dealt, an excellent lecture he has given. Professor Absar Ahmed, congratulations to you. And all our participants are, I hope that they are very happy. And this is an emerging science, nanotechnology. And when I visited some years back to that particular place, Pune, to the Agarkar Research Institute, I have visited Dr. Absar Ahmed laboratory also, and I had a talk with him. Only thing is we could not publish a paper along with him or with me. And there have been some setbacks and all that is there, but otherwise we were thinking of having the collaborative also. But nevertheless, nevertheless, he is a person who has started this particular nanobiotechnology here in India, and I'm very happy to see him as the director of nanotechnology laboratory at Aligarh Muslim University. His efforts are not gone waste, and his efforts, sincere efforts, so as to say that here is a personality who can deliver the goods in the years to come for this particular country. He is very faithful to the nation, faithful to the people, and faithful to his subject, teaching and research. That is the character of Dr. Afsar Ahmed. And I think in near future, definitely after COVID, I would like to visit Aligarh Muslim University. There have been standing invitation many more times. And some students were asking me whether this nanoparticles can be recovered after getting into the body, or whether they can be recovered or they cannot be recovered.
Yes, sir. Now, just we tested that one, sir. We injected the nanoparticle, because most of the nanoparticles which we are making, we used to keep the size 20 to 25 nanometer. And our kidney can filter up to 50 nanometer. So we injected the nanoparticle into the rat. And after that, nanoparticles are passing from the urine. Why they are passing? Because the size is very small. So agar now, if you have 2 to 25 nanometer, they will pass from the kidney. If you have bigger nanoparticles, they will expect in the kidney. So most of the nanoparticles which our group is making, we used to keep the size 20 to 25, 30 nanometer. So we have seen, we showed the slide also, the moment we injected into the rat, and they are passing from the urine. So they will deliver the drug and they will pass from the urine. That's why toxicity is not a problem in the case of the nanoparticle which we are making from the fungus and plant extract. We have proved that.
So now nanotechnology has become a productive science. And on behalf of Dr. Aleem Khan and on behalf of Telangana University and faculty, and also the refresher course participants, I profusely thank Dr. Professor Afsar Ahmed for your very knowledgeable and informative lecture. And you have proved yourself that your products will be in the years to come, they will be useful to cure many number of diseases. And I think medical nanotechnology will be the science, upcoming science in near future. So I thank you, sir. I thank you very much. How is your family at the same time? I met your family also. Yeah.
Okay, sir. Thank you very much. And sir, we will publish the paper together very soon.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. All the best. God bless you. And your family. And I must congratulate Dr. Aleem Khan. When I told about Dr. Afsar Ahmed, your Telangana University has agreed, and Academy has also agreed, and many more good things to happen to Dr. Afsar Ahmed in near future. As long as I am there, I hope that I can do something for. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for joining with us.
Thank you, sir.
We are very happy. The proud woman for the Department of Botany, Telangana University, that you are with us today, and we could witness, or we could again become a part of your presentation, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Dear participants, our today's four lectures of today, the refresher course has come to an end. And tomorrow we have four more lectures. First lecture will be by Professor R. Umashankar, sir, from University of Agriculture Science, Bengaluru. He'll be speaking on DNA barcoding and systematics. And then we have a very known towering personality with us tomorrow, Professor Akhilesh K. Tyagi, sir, from University of Delhi. He will be talking on diversifying plant genomes. And then we'll have Professor Tapan Kumar Adhyaya, sir. He'll be talking on soil biodiversity, life beneath our feet. And then we have a little bit confusion whether S.R. Yadav, sir, will be there, because he today texted a message that they are having some NAC visit in the university or something, but I suppose that he will be joining us. If not, we are having three short lectures. So please copy the YouTube link of today's afternoon session I have shared in the chat box, kindly join us tomorrow again at least 10 minutes before the lecture, because lecture is going to begin at sharp 10 o'clock, and you are requested to join us 10 minutes before, and the Zoom will be started by 9:45. 15 minutes earlier only we are going to start the Zoom. So kindly cooperate with us. Today it was a wonderful day that we could see more than 35 participants were there in the meeting, and I expect that many of them were sent email communication from our department mail, but most of them couldn't check out the email because it meant some participant warning was telling that it meant to spam. So kindly, if you are having in touch with your other friends who have joined in this meeting, I inform them to check the spam and get back to us in the meeting, because all these videos we need to share with the academies where they will be checking the attendance of one and all. So this is a rare opportunity for Department of Botany. Somebody has raised the hand. Yes.
Good afternoon, sir. Sir, can you please share the link, YouTube link of the morning session?
Morning session, I will check it out because I have given you the afternoon session.
Yes, sir. Got it. I have checked it.
You copy it, and if you go to my channel, you can YouTube channel, you will be getting that also, I hope.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, one and all. And as the time is 10 minutes earlier, we are ending the meeting. So hope all of them are having their own busy schedule, and this virtual kind of program is meant so that we can enhance our knowledge under the shade of our C. Manoharachari sir. We are very thankful for sir because his acceptance made our program very, colorful. So today it was a brilliant day that we have got our local people and also people from various parts. As you can see, from Tamil Nadu we have participants, from Maharashtra we have participants, from Odisha we have participants, and from Andhra Pradesh and Telangana also participants are there. At least more than 5 states participants are there in this refresher course. And if you have any specific requirement regarding, you need any selection letter or something or anything, please you drop the email to us so that we can help you in getting your permission or whatever sort of things are there. As we have communicated you the selection letter, similar selection email, similarly we'll help you. But kindly be in the meeting every day. The meeting will begin at 10 o'clock and end at 12:30. And then afternoon session will start at 1:30. And it will end as like today, 4 o'clock. So please, I request once again to all the participants, be in the Zoom link, same link will be there. We will be starting the Zoom at the before lecture commencement. So thank you one and all. With permission, Chari sir, can I now end the meeting?
Yeah. Please. Thank you very much, Dr. Alim Khan.
Okay. Participants, please kindly join us again tomorrow back. Vidya ma'am and Aruna ma'am, we will be ending the meeting now. Okay, thank you one and all. Please, you use the same link for Zoom tomorrow also. Tomorrow again, we'll see you back. Okay, thank you.
Right, thank you.